My name is Mithun Prabhu. I'm an IT professional myself and an avid travel photographer. It is an extreme pleasure on behalf of Honeycomb to welcome Bhushan Bagadia, who is practicing a genre of photography which most of us as photographers do not. At least I do not know of a lot of people who practice this genre of photography, which is underwater photography in India. So it's an extreme pleasure to welcome Bhushan, and I'm sure, like I am excited, you all who are listening in to this conversation will also be excited. So Bhushan, welcome on behalf of Honeycomb.
Thanks, Mithun.
Welcome. So with your permission, I would want to have a quick conversation with you. Shall we proceed, Bhushan?
Absolutely.
Wonderful. So Bhushan, first question to you is, how did you come to love photography? Were there any earlier influences in your life before you started?
I can't recall any incident as such, but photography was always something that I just did. It was a thing that was on the side, like from when I was a kid, it was just like taking the camera which my dad had or whatever else was just, it was always a thing that I loved doing. Mm-hmm. At that time, I never imagined that photography would be my line of work, ever. It was just something that I liked doing, and it was like one of those things that I did all the time. And it was like, if we are on a trip, I would shoot photos. If I was at home, I would be shooting photos. It was never, like, I never thought that it would become a line of work. It was always something that I just did because I liked it. So I don't know of an incident as a thing that started it, but if all I know is that it has been there ever since.
Right. So Bhushan, I think personally, I think that, you know, each one of us normally have, you know, a reason why we get into, you know, maybe it is, you know, parents, or maybe it is friends, or maybe it is just general. But I think it is not wrong to say that, you know, I am myself an inspiration, you know, so I got inspired, you know, because I wanted to do it, you know, something like that. So I think in your case, it's I wanted to do it, so I became, you know, so which is itself a big achievement, I guess, you know, so. That's how I would say, you know, probably it would be.
That's one way to look at it.
Right. You know, because see, the reason I'm saying is, you know, there are so many people, I'm sure, in this, who are listening to this conversation also. Then, you know, a lot of them are aspiring. I know a lot of, personally, I know a lot of people who actually quit their jobs to become full-time photographers, you know, without even, you know, looking at what area they want to get into. So that, I don't think that personally that's wrong, you know, but then, you know, as long as you can practice and you can, you know, I'm sure you agree with it, you know, so.
You know. Of course, if you can sustain with it, then why not?
Correct, right. So gone were the days, you know, when photographers used to be only wedding photographers, and now we have, you know, all genres of photography. So, you know, I think, I think that's great, Bhushan. Thank you very much. So next, you know, I would like to probably know, you know, in your, you know, so like I said, you know, it's a very different genre of photography, which is underwater photography. You know, is that the only thing that you practice as such, or do you practice any other genres as well apart from this?
So basically, like, I think it's wrong to say that a photographer will shoot only one type of thing. Right. But I mean, I shoot lots of different things, but the way my life has gone and the work has come in, last, I think, 7-8 years, it's been underwater photography because I love it, and sports photography. So I became a sports photographer by accident. I used to, like, because I had, I had studied film. So I could edit videos and shoot videos. And photography was something that I always did. So when there was a time in 2013, there was a requirement at IPL, and the call came to me in the middle of the night, and the next morning I was already with the team, even before I could come to terms with what was happening. The only criteria was that they wanted someone who can shoot photos, shoot videos and edit videos and on the go, like travel with the team.
Wow.
And that criteria gave me that job. But since then, it just, like, it's my interest in sports photography. Like, I realized that I was very interested in it because I liked sports. And then sports photography became my main line of photography.
If you don't mind, if I can ask you, which team of IPL did you travel with?
2013 and 14, I was with Mumbai Indians.
Arre wah, very good.
And I mean, 2013 was the good year because that was Sachin's last year. So
you had a fortune of meeting him as well and shooting.
Oh, we had many conversations also.
Wow.
It was a good year to be with Mumbai Indians because they had never won the cup.
Right.
and that was Sachin last year. And so there was so much hype around this thing, and the way I got into it is actually funny. So the requirement, the IPL, the pre-season had already started. And I got a call in the middle of the night from somebody saying that there is a football, I mean, there's a sports team that needs this thing. This is a requirement. Somebody recommended you. Are you interested? I said, yeah. Then they said, but I'm not the person, there's someone else. And they kept passing me on to different people, not revealing what the team is or what the work, who the work is for. Finally, the guy who's actually in charge for Mumbai Indians spoke to me at some, I think some 11:30 in the night. And he said, okay, this is for Mumbai Indians, it's for IPL. We need you to join the next day and for 45 days and all of that. And I said, yeah, it's possible. Then he just asked me to send some work. Then I asked him, why this emergency? Like, someone like Mumbai Indians would be well planned and all that. So their photographer that year got chickenpox. So they sent him off immediately because it can't affect the players. Right. And they needed someone to replace him overnight because in 2 days was Sachin's birthday.
Oh.
So they needed someone to be there to create content or whatever else. So it like in less than 12 hours from the call that I got, I was sitting in front of Ricky Ponting discussing what to interview him about. So for me, it was surreal. Like I can't, I mean, the whole season went by before I realized that it had hit me. It was like that.
So I think like they normally say, you know, that somebody's loss is somebody's gain. You know, so I think you are a perfect example of that.
Absolutely. I gained very well with it.
Right. No, and you should, you know, see, no money can buy, you know, that, you know, experience that you got, you know, and why you, right? I mean, you have to also think, you know, there was something written for you somewhere. So I think this is, I think, very important for a lot of aspiring photographers, you know, who are listening to this conversation, that you never know, you know, you should keep, you know, doing your good work and, you know, showcasing it, I guess, you know, and then you never know, you know, when fortune strikes. You know, and when
that's
it strikes,
the only way. That's the only way. You have to put yourself out there and be open to doing anything and keep doing work. Not like, I mean, for me, what never worked is saying, okay, I'm going to do this. Then it never happens. Like to reach somewhere. If I say I'm just going to do what I love, and then everything has come. Like
right.
some level. So
which means you practice other genres of photography as well, and you know, while sports is your primary genre that you practice and you know make a living out of it.
Yeah, sports is what I earn from, and I spend it all on my underwater photography.
And we'll come to that. Okay, so next, Bhushan, want to know, so what is that, you know, what is that one thing that inspires you and to, you know, keep pursuing photography? I'm sure there are a lot of inspirations in your life, you know, but anything that you want to list down first?
Is it just general photography or underwater?
I mean, let's talk about underwater, you know, because that's something that you practice a lot.
So, in 2006, I went diving for the first time, and this was in UK. I had gone to visit my sister and I didn't want to do anything touristy. So I said, let me just find something online. And my sister and me liked the water. So we said, let's go dive. And it's actually a really bad place to dive. The diving is horrible. The conditions are bad. It's cold water and no marine life, all that. But that experience of being underwater was amazing. Then I couldn't dive for 3 years. But then 3 years later, I went to Thailand and I took a break. I said, okay, 3 months, I'm going to go there and I'm going to just dive and all that. When I started diving there, I met a company that makes films underwater over there. So I walked into their office. I said, I want to learn what is this and all that. They said, if you want to intern with us, come. So I said, sure. So I came back to India, got a longer visa, and I went and I worked with them. That time that I spent there just was actually two of my favorite things. One was taking photographs and diving. Diving had become a thing, like diving is an addiction. So it just merged so well that now there's so much more to shoot underwater in the world, like marine life wise, and every dive is different. So that the amount of inspiration that it can give me to keep doing this more, I have more than how much, I mean, I can live it through and still there'll be more. That's how much the ocean is so wide. There's so much happening. So much marine life to shoot, so there is no dearth of inspiration.
I guess, like we, as photographers, you know, those who practice astrophotography, you know, specifically, we say that, you know, there is like universe has no end, you know. So similarly is, you know, astro. So nobody can say that, you know, I have covered everything. irrespective of, you know, how much investment you do in terms of telescopes or, you know, in terms of equipments. So I'm sure, you know, it is the same, you know, the ocean has no, you know, length and breadth, you know, it is infinite, you know, in every direction and stuff. And you have depth also, you know, you can imagine that you have depth, you have length and you have breadth also, you know, so, you know, everything to cover, you know,
And if once you start diving, you know that you can dive in the same dive spot every day for a month and you would have still, every time you will see something new.
Something different, yes.
And this is like the bigger fish. Everybody thinks of the sharks is that when you start going smaller and macro, it's infinite. The number of things that you can notice and see and all that. So possibilities are endless.
Like you know, I normally tell a lot of folks who look at my pictures that if you stand at a spot, you know, and every morning if you see the sunrise and sunset, so on the same spot, you will find that, you know, every time it is different. The sun is same. But, you know, the drama that it creates, you know, with the clouds, sometimes with, you know, the rays, the angles, the shadows, you know, it's every time, every day different, you know. So you cannot say that, you know, what, you know, every day is sunrise, every day sunset, of course, you know. So it's, I think it's the same, like you rightly said, you know, I think I agree with you.
Kind of absolutely. And with respect to sunrise, we are actually blessed to be in Bangalore. The skies are beautiful. Bangalore skies have always fascinated me since I was a kid.
Right. So just to clarify, when you said diving, so is that something like the scuba diving that you do?
Yeah.
Okay.
So this is basically scuba diving, and I'm certified. So I'm certified up to 3 levels. So that's a rescue diver.
Oh, okay.
And yeah, I mean, to shoot underwater, you can either be ideally you should be a certified scuba diver or a free diver. But mainly scuba diving is what you need to certify in. Otherwise, you can't go and dive in these places.
No, but I can imagine that, you know, with that entire suit that you put, plus the camera gear, you know, to protect, it would be, and the cylinder, you know, so I'm sure, you know, it is like a huge challenge by itself.
The challenge is when you are on land or on the boat, because that is where it's all heavy. Once you're in the water, it's weightless, right? So then it's easy. So it's best to remain underwater. If you're outside, it's a problem.
It is. I have tried scuba in the past, not as a certified, but, you know, just a touristy thing. But, you know, it was so difficult. You know, I can't even imagine, you know, taking a camera.
The initial process of learning scuba diving is tough.
It's tough.
Yeah. For anybody, like even for me. But it's like learning how to cycle, you know. Like, you don't know when you learn how to balance. With diving, it's like that. You don't know when you start becoming comfortable with that gear on you.
Right.
You don't notice it. Then it's just like it's like having a backpack on you and you're doing what you're doing. So.
Absolutely. Okay. So moving on, Bhushan, just wanted to understand, you know, so how do you feel when your work is viewed and appreciated by a large audience?
So this is something that's a very awkward thing for me generally, because photography was never something that I wanted to show people or do it. I did it for myself. And even now I still do it for myself. It's odd that when someone sees it and appreciates it, I still have to learn how to say, okay, yeah, thank you and whatever. It's a learning process still. But that said, it does feel nice. It feels nice when people appreciate the photography and like to be featured in articles and all that is nice. But I think more than me, my parents are happy that is happening. So that is a good thing.
Right.
Because I come from a Gujarati family with a background where I was supposed to take over my dad's business, but I didn't do any of that. So that way, at least that they are happy that, okay, this fellow, whatever he's doing, is at least doing it well. And so that, with that regard, I like the appreciation. But yeah, I mean, it's a feel good factor. So nice.
Yeah. So I think you are a lot humble and modest to mention that. But yeah, I'm sure, you know, you have, you know, any kind of appreciation, small, big, you know, makes anyone happy. So I'm sure, you know, so.
Yeah, you are as well. I mean, it will push you to do more. So.
Right. And see, what better can it be that if you can be an inspiration for somebody else? You know, and if that somebody else does win awards or, you know, win something, there's nothing like it. That's the best thing it can be.
Absolutely.
Right. Okay. So moving on, tell us, you know, about how often do you practice, you know, underwater photography? Do you really set some time from your busy schedule? I'm sure you have a lot of other assignments, you know, from the sports and other thing happening. Or do you just you know, decide one day that, okay, now I'm in this place, let's go there. You know, of course, in the COVID situation might be difficult, but otherwise, you know, do you really plan, or does it just happen? You get bored and you say, okay, let's do it.
So with respect to underwater, one, it does take a lot of planning anytime, because there is a lot of gear that is additional to just a camera and a lens. You can't just easily take off, because the underwater housing and the strobes and the cables and all that is actually one big bag. And but what I have done is, whenever I've traveled for anything, I'm always looking out for places where I can dive. So if I was shooting something in Thailand, I'm saying, okay, I can dive there. Or if I go to Bali, or like other places in India, Pondicherry, Goa, whatever else, I'm always looking at where I can dive. That moved on to saying, okay, now if I'm going to a place where I can dive, I will take my camera with me, my underwater housing with me. So that was one thing, to like travel for work and then I extend the trip into this. That kept happening everywhere. But apart from that, any break that I got, I would be diving and shooting underwater. Like I literally have spent everything that I've made in making those trips happen. In buying the underwater housing and all that. So like the joke among my friend circle is that I stay underwater more than on land, if you actually count the number of hours. So it's something that
maybe you were a fish in your last life.
I wish I was a fish now. I could just live there.
Because like they, in our mythology and tradition, we say, right, that there are certain wishes which are not fulfilled in the last life. So, you fulfill it in this life, so that is,
I have number of hours underwater that I have to clock in this life.
right. Absolutely. I think that itself is a big inspiration for everyone who is listening to, because if you do not practice, what you want to be good at, and you say that, let me do it only when an assignment comes, or, only when I go to this place, I don't think that will work, anything that you do.
The only way you can get good at it is by doing it. And if you love it, then you should just do it more, because then you'll enjoy that anyway.
Right.
And that's the only way to get good at it.
Absolutely. Great. So Bhushan, can you share with us, some of your achievements in the underwater photography? I mean, have you received any kind of, awards, recognitions, etc. Into this?
So, I mean, there are, I'm very wary of photography awards and contests and all that. I never want to enter into it, because again, photography is not something that I want to like put into this thing where I'm judged for it or whatever else. But there was one contest that happened in India where it was an all India thing, where my friends kept pushing me, saying that enter. It was an underwater photography contest. So with great hesitance, I did it. And the thing that was not nice about it is, once I had entered, I wanted to know what was going to happen. So that was the anticipation was a problem. But thankfully, like one of the photos I shot of it was a conservation category that I had entered in. And I had a photo of a shark with a fishing hook stuck in its mouth.
Oh.
And that won first place.
Wow.
So
which means, like wildlife photographers get in because, some of them are naturalists themselves, so they also want to educate a lot of people, with respect to how they should, preserve the wildlife, the flora, fauna, and all that stuff. So I'm sure, the same thing happens with marine life as well.
Absolutely. In fact, once you start shooting underwater, you notice so much more as you're shooting. Then you have stories to tell. Like this thing of the fishing hooks in the shark's mouth, you will see it in so many places around the world that it's shocking. Like, it's not like one area where there is more fishing happening that is happening. You will see sharks with scars, with fishing hooks, this, that, at so many places. Then that makes you think that, okay, why is this happening? Is it right? Is it wrong? And then, so it is all connected with the world and the planet and our understanding of it at a very large level.
Right, absolutely. Wonderful. So Bhushan, if you can tell us something about, are you part of any photographic communities or anything of the sort, like clubs or, anything that you are, or any Facebook groups or anything, especially in underwater photography?
So I'm not, I'm part of some groups that I follow, but I'm not very active on all these things. I'm very old school. I'm very wary about social media. I I mean, I still post and do all that stuff, but I'm not part of a group as such, like which I'm active on. But in my circle, like with some underwater photographers who I've met through social media, online or in person, I'm in touch with everyone. And we all like help each other with whatever we need. We're constantly sharing tips. We're constantly sharing photos. So it's not really like a public thing, but there's a lot of one-on-one with a lot of people that I've met in my life. So that's sort of like a group that I have, which is...
Absolutely. Wonderful. Great. You know, so for your work that you do, you know, because it's something that not everybody practices, you know, so, but do you receive, you know, critics for your work? You know, if yes, then how do you handle them? Especially, you know, the question is more also towards, you know, a lot of aspiring photographers, when they get in, they cannot handle critics well. You know, they feel that, you know, oh, you know, he or she is, you know, saying that, you know, this is not good. Whereas, you know, I feel it is very good, you know, so something of that sort. So what do you advise them? How do you handle yourself?
Well, see, the thing with criticism is that the first response is always that it's like, you know, I think I've done a good job. Why are you telling me this? But criticism is also a good thing. I have very close friends who are my very, very strong critics. They will not just appreciate everything that I post. So that's a good thing, actually. But the one thing that it does is that it will push you to make something better. But the basic thing that I've always followed and believe, which is true, I feel, is that there is still a lot for me to learn. Even though I've shot underwater for so many years, there is a lot. I still have to learn, and there's constant learning, improving. So I think if you have that mindset, then somebody criticizing anything that you've done or critiquing your work, then you'll always approach it with the fact that maybe there is something I can learn from that.
Right.
And then you learn and improve with it. It could be something tangible. A lot of times it's very intangible. Like you've learned it, but it's not like a thing that, okay, I've learned this. But you are learning. You're constantly growing. You won't make a mistake that you did last time. You make new mistakes, or you'll improve that. So critics are always good.
Yeah, and I think it makes us as photographers, if you take it in the right spirit, you know, to improvise as well, you know, because
absolutely,
you know, every person's view of, you know, looking at creativity is completely different. You know, so you should always take, you know, the positive inputs, you know, from them, you know, and, you know, maybe there is always a scope to, you know, it's not about to please somebody, you know, but what I normally say, Bhushan, is that, you know, you should be happy, you know, clicking, and you should be convinced that it is the right, you know, picture, you know, because convincing anybody else, you know, is not possible, you know, because everybody will have a different opinion, you know, but then
absolutely,
you should be convinced, you know, kind of stuff. I think that's very critical.
That's right. The only thing, like, and there is no perfect photograph. Every photograph is looked at with so many different ways and how it's shot. So right, as long as you're happy and you're doing it and you're doing it right,
that's it. Right. Correct. Okay. So, what is your take on the digital world, which is blooming, you know, because, there is so much of technology, into everything, you know, whether it is equipments or software or, you know, whatever we use for our, you know, pictures, you know, kind of stuff. So and what do you think is there a scope of technology in photography?
Well, the one thing with the boom in digital, the digital world, is that there are a lot more photographers today. It's easy to pick up a camera. It's easy to get a camera in your budget and still shoot well and whatever else. That whole bit and the understanding of how easy it is to shoot, to get it edited, to get it out there, it's a lot easier. So, but it's a double-edged sword, I feel. So more people getting in is also a good thing and a bad thing. But
right,
the one thing that I feel that is lacking is that because it's so easy, people are skipping learning the basics of photography. Like today, the cameras are getting more and more intelligent, so it's easier to shoot. They learn basically just how much needs to be shot, but what it is, that what does a photograph mean? What does light do? How does it operate? Those things I don't think a lot of people get into.
Right.
While that's not necessary to be a photographer today, I feel that if you do it, then you'll enjoy your photography more. Like you'll understand how any of these things are working. So that is the only thing I feel that the digital boom is changing. Like it's getting people to just jump into it too soon. And there's no like journey of learning and all that. But then it's individual. Like some people, I also know some people who just started, but they've gone and read up and learned a lot because they are interested. So, and then to be able to stand out in this kind of a crowd is an achievement. So it's good that there are so many more people. And then now it's like, first it used to be 20 photographers. Now there are 2000. And then if you're standing out, then that already is an achievement. So.
Right. Absolutely. So what are your plans, future plans with respect to, photography, especially underwater, and how do you plan to achieve them, if there's any?
There are so many places that I haven't dived, and there are so many places that I've dived and I want to keep diving because of the kind of marine life and the aquatic life that I've seen, and I want to shoot all of that. So plans-wise, I think this is the roadmap for my life. I'm going to earn money and I'm going to spend it on diving and shooting underwater and documenting more marine life and shooting more marine life around the world. And I don't think I'll be able to do it in one lifetime. That's how much there is to shoot underwater. How I'm going to do it, you see, it's always been a thing that I know that this is what I want to do. Like there are people who plan like a holiday or like buying a house and all that. I have none of that. For me, it is now I have time, I have free days, I have some money. Let me go dive in a new place. So it is travel and all that, but it is always diving and underwater photography centric. Most of my holidays.
Wow. Okay. That itself is, a big inspiration for a lot of people, that if you're very serious about it, might as well utilize, the money that you make, the new places that you get to travel, the new things that you get to shoot, and you never know when there is a next opportunity. So I think that itself is very critical. Great. I know that you mentioned sometime back that you're not a very social media person, but then still I want to ask, do you publish your work onto social media? If yes, maybe you can, let for the benefit of our audience, mention what are those Instagram handles or, whatever you publish them on. And a very, very critical question, which most of the people want to know, and they always like to know, is how important is social media platforms, irrespective of which one it is, to publish or highlight your work, especially from a photography perspective.
So I post on Instagram and on Facebook. I have a page on Facebook and on Instagram. My handle is Bhushan Bagadia Positive. But for me to start it is also a funny story. I shot a wedding once long back, many, many years back, and that couple loved the photos and the video, and they said, "Where is your page? Where do we tag you?" I said, "I don't have all that. I just do this because I love it." They refused to post their wedding photos or share it till I started a page. I said, okay, I'm starting. And that actually got me to start my Instagram account and my Facebook page and all that. But after that, I never posted anything except like for a long time till I said, okay, now let me just post and all that. When I started posting my underwater stuff, the one thing it did was it connected me with underwater photographers from around the world. And that was amazing because suddenly I had like people who did underwater photography for a long, much longer time than me, or who were like starting off or had seen something in a place where the diving was nice and they had documented it. And suddenly, because of the social media network, I got in touch with so many people, which was amazing. So then I started posting a lot more. I'm mostly active on Instagram, but Facebook, it just links with Instagram, so it keeps getting posted there. But the Instagram posting and whatever reach I've got has actually connected me with some fabulous people. I've interacted with photographers whose work I had actually been seeing and following, and suddenly I could talk to them because we had connected on Instagram. So it actually made the whole world like open up to me, and the network was accessible easily. So that way, that whole social media thing helped. And it's the good thing, obviously, is that that's already a platform for you to put your work. You don't need to like create something and reach out to people and all that. When you put something there, there is audience that's coming in. Of course, there are algorithms and you have to pay and all that stuff. But besides all that, it's already a place to showcase your work. So that's amazing. And for people to post, I feel that when I started posting, earlier I was very, very hesitant. Then 1 year I said, okay, I'm going to do one post a day. And that became a challenge for me because then I was like, because I'm very particular about what I post. There is a little story that I write out and all that. So each post takes me like a few hours, at least then. Now it's a little faster. But so then I started posting like that, and that started, like, apart from me reaching out to people, lots of people started reaching out to me. And this was new to me. It wasn't like normally my network would be who I meet or some word of mouth or something else. Now suddenly these are people I had, they were not a part of my circle. They were not a part of anywhere that I would reach out to them. And they were from some other country, other part of the world. And we were talking and we were discussing stuff. We were, so that what that did was actually lovely, even in terms of what I learned from them, what I could share, what I could, maybe I could, maybe there are some trips that I've planned because I've met them. And I said, okay, here the diving is good, marine life is good. So I've done trips based on that. So the best thing about social media is that it opens up the whole world to you. Like there is no, there are no borders, there's no boundaries then. So that is a good thing, and that it did that to me. Like it helped me a lot. The only thing I would say for people who are starting or whatever else is that though there are algorithms and though there are these things which are controlled by saying, oh, you have to pay for followers, all that, I think that is a separate topic altogether. But just keep posting and you will have a place where you can showcase your work, and it will grow. The network will happen. And it's happened to me. Like, that's how my network has grown. I've met lots of people who are fabulous, who are paid followers. And I don't think I will as yet. I don't know how that's going to work. But main thing is that it's putting your work out there is important. That I realize now. And it's nice for people to see it and then to network with that.
I think, it is very important, you know, because if you use the social media platforms into the right, right purpose, right spirit, and grow organically, you know, there's nothing like it, you know, because if people like your work, they will anyways follow you. They will do brand collaborations with you. They will want to, you know, talk to you. They will want to admire your work. They will want to get inspired by your work, you know, like I said, you know, sometime back, you never know whom you inspire, you know, if that person becomes, maybe a renowned photographer or, you know, something of that sort, you know, it's good for, anyone who, does that, you know, as long as there is gratitude for people to acknowledge. But I think you touched a very important point, you know, because a lot of people do put in, you know, but they don't know what the content is, you know, and I there are two things that I want to say, you know. One is I am very much, like your thought process that, I today put, for the entire 2020, I've been putting one picture a day. It's actually called as hashtag one picture a day 2020.
Because
by doing that, one is that it challenges me to think about which picture to put today. And then second is it makes me, and I like writing, you know, because for me, like you rightly said, you know, as you also mentioned that, you know, putting something, you know, makes more sense, you know, that helps me express. Like, you know, in the olden days, we used to say that, you know, write a diary, express your feelings, you know, kind of stuff. So today probably the social media is more of that diary, which is known to people.
Absolutely.
Kind of stuff. There are a lot of people who just put a picture and not put anything, which is also fine if you don't have time. But according to me, you know, there should be something so that, you know, there are a lot of people who don't know, certain areas that we click or, you know, certain things. So they are very curious. They find it very, very, very intriguing to even know that, oh, does this really exist? I have seen this so many times, but how can your camera see, you know, maybe your lens is better, you know, so there's nothing of that sort, you know, everything is the same. So I think that's a very important thing. And second thing I wanted to mention was, you know, on a lighter note, Bhushan, so after hearing, you know, for so much time now that we had a conversation, now I think, you know, like that movie Accidental Prime Minister, you should have an Accidental Photographer title movie for you. You know, because everything seems to be happening accidentally for you.
So, yeah, it is.
You know, so you got into social media by accident. You got into sports, IPL by accident. You know, so it is very interesting to know, as to how those, I don't know why those accidents only happen with you. You know, with the right spirit.
I think it's the only thing about having the right approach. I was open to it and it came to me. That's it. And the belief that you just keep doing it, it will come to you.
Absolutely.
So even like to be impatient and think that should, like, everybody's journey is going to be different. Like if you want to get into, like, say, if there are five people who quit their jobs to do photography today, there is no guarantee that all five can make a calculated plan for the year. Each one is going to network differently. Each one is going to get work differently. So each one's journey is their own. And you have to be willing.
Some people just don't get it also, you know, so that's also true.
Yeah, of course.
So whether you call it as bad luck or, you know, whether you call it as not the right approach. But I think, but that's okay. You should try. You should keep trying. And that's the only thing that will sustain. Great. So last question, Bhushan, for you is, you know, have you heard about Honeycomb Creative Support, the PhotoStop specific, you know, the printing brand under Honeycomb Creative Support? If yes, have you utilized the services? You know, do you have any experiences to share, Bhushan?
Yeah, so I there was a time that I needed to print something because I was gifting it, gifting one of my first prints. I was actually ever going to print. I was going to gift it to someone. So I just searched online and I'd asked a few people. They'd given me some numbers. They said, okay, this printer might be good, whatever, whatever. Then I found Honeycomb and PhotoStop just by chance, again by accident, online, and I said, okay, there's the way they detailed it out looked interesting. So I just called. But my experience with them right from the start has been great. Their customer support is nice. They actually understand what photographers want, and they had already printed a lot of stuff for photographers. So when I spoke to them, they actually suggested that for this, because there is a lot of black in it, print on this paper and all that. And they gave me my first print, and to me it looked great. But it's after that I started understanding a lot more about what kind of paper, why should you print on this, why should you use that kind of print, what happens when you print on canvas, how much color loss, this, that. But I started understanding all that after that, and since then I've only printed with them. I did an exhibition once, I was invited to do an exhibition, I did one donation drive, all of these things I've always printed with them. Wonderful. And they're lovely, like, it's, and I've never ever seen, I don't know where their office is, I don't know where they print from. I've only found them online, spoken to them on the phone and WhatsApp, and it's happened perfectly. So.
Right. So to answer that question, where are they in India? They are in Bangalore, in Koramangala, in Hyderabad, and in Bombay. You know, these are the three locations. But then everything happens, you know, via emails or phone calls or WhatsApp, and then, you know, it gets shipped.
To me, they are on my WhatsApp.
Right.
That's it.
Right. So you know, it all gets shipped across national and international based on, you know, this thing. And I have been myself a customer of Honeycomb for last 5 odd years. I did my 2 exhibitions, solo exhibitions last year. So I can definitely, you know, agree to your point of, you know, the subject matter expertise that has been brought in. Because, you know, there are a lot of people who, you know, consider it as a transaction. You know, a lot of other printers, you know, where it is more like, you know, take the job and get it done. You know, but then here there is, you know, so since you mentioned about the black part of the printing, I can tell you that, you know, earlier I used to print on the enhanced absent man paper, but then blacks, you know, typically get a lot of, you know, this thing. So, you know, it was a suggestion that why don't you use the premium luster, you know, because that, you know, takes off all that problem. So now even if I did not ask for the suggestion, there is a suggestion, you know, so which is what I kind of stopped, you know, so I think that's what it is. So I agree with you. So that's great. Now one last thing, Bhushan, is I'm sure, you know, the reason why we are doing this conversation also is, you know, you should let our viewers know about the webinar that you will be hosting, you know, with us, kind of stuff. So do you want to talk about it, Bhushan?
So the webinar, I mean, if you do attend my webinar, which is on August 18th at 8 p.m., I mean, it's going to be a short journey of what I went through, or how I got into underwater photography. There were a lot of challenges, so I will be talking to you about the challenges that I faced and how I overcame them. And then I will be taking you through, I mean, it's very difficult to pick my favorites, but 10 of my favorite photographs and maybe a little story behind each of them and how I managed to shoot it or what that meant to me and all of that. So yeah, I think it should be interesting.
It should be interesting. It will be interesting. You know, I'm very excited. So I'm definitely going to be, you know, the first one, because I'm going to speak to you on that day as well, you know. But then I think, for all those who are listening, you know, and especially like I mentioned at the start of this conversation, underwater, there are very few photographers in India, you know, so this is absolutely a chance to hear Bhushan talk about it, show his, you know, best 10 pictures, especially the story behind each one of them, the challenges that he spoke about. So do not miss registering for the underwater, you know, webinar that Bhushan will be part of. All the details will be provided soon. You know, so I think it's going to be, you know, one of those lovely evenings where there'll be a lot of, you know, interaction and a lot of knowledge sharing. Thank you very much, Bhushan.
Looking forward to it. Thank you so much.
Great. So thank you, Bhushan, for your time. I know you would be busy with a lot of other, you know, engagements. It was lovely talking to you, Bhushan. And I hope to see you, you know, during the webinar.
Thank you so much.
Wonderful.